everyone. Okay, well, we have a quorum, so we can go ahead. I will bring to order this September 3rd meeting of the Salina City Planning Commission. Our first item on the agenda is approval of the summary minutes from August 20. Is there comment or a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to approve the summary minutes from the August 20, 2013 regular meeting.
And I'll second that.
You may have to turn on your, is your mic on?
I'm on. It's on. It says we're on.
It says we're on.
We have little green lights.
Okay.
That doesn't work for you.
He says
maybe
it's
a
gone.
Wire got cut. You think?
My mic seems to be working.
Can you, I'll try.
Can you hear us now?
Can't hear? Can you hear?
You're now? On now. I can hear you.
Well, it's not very loud because if you get right on it, you can. Maybe somebody could turn it up. How do we turn it up?
After last meeting, the city commissioners may have shut your mic off, Ken.
Well, that could be the
off
too, though. Am I off or on?
John's. Let me see if his is working.
Yeah. It's working. Yeah. It's single me out.
No, everybody commented except me, and I'm the only one who's got a mic on. No.
We'll talk louder and talk closer.
Oh, we have a motion. Is there a second?
I second that motion.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. That item carries. We have a public hearing item today, public hearing on proposed changes to the street circulation system around Kansas Westland. A staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will just lay out a couple things for you to describe where we are procedurally. And the application that we have in front of us today is an application for a replat of the block that's bounded by South 4th Street on the west, Claflin on the north, Osborne Street on the east, and Cloud Street on the south. As part of that, there is a policy that the City Commission adopted that said whenever there's a petition or proposal to permanently close or vacate a open public street, there needs to be a public hearing on that held by the Planning Commission. So you are in a dual role today of looking at a proposed replat, but you're also conducting a public hearing on proposed street changes. The other thing I want to make clear is that the initial application and plan that was filed by Wilson & Company on behalf of Kansas Westland called for the complete closure of the east side or east leg of South 4th Street. And subsequent to that initial filing, they have modified their plan and more or less taken that off the table, but we will explain that as we get into this in more detail. First thing we wanted to explain was that the rail line was here first. And so it was constructed in the 1870s, and then in 1886 there was a plat of the addition to the grounds of Kansas Wesleyan University, and so the plat came along after the railroad was already in place. So John, I'm going to ask you if you have it, and maybe you don't have, do you have the plat of the grounds of Kansas Wesleyan University? It is in your packet. If John does not have it for you to display, but what is important about it is the fact that it may not be obvious, but there are what looks like streets and alleys and 30 individual platted lots. So what you see on the right hand side is a former stream that used to run across the Sacred Heart St. Mary's property and flow north to the Smoky Hill River. That was later converted to the Second Street Slough, but at the time this property was platted, there was a stream there. And then you'll also see that Russell Street was initially platted to connect between 4th Street and Osborne, and there were a couple east-west alleys there as well. And there are 30 individual platted lots there. So if you look at what's on the surface of the ground there today, it doesn't really bear any relationship to how the property is platted. And so if we look at this sequentially, the railroad was there first, then along came the plat for the grounds, the addition to the grounds of Kansas Wesleyan University. And then in 1923, the city entered into a 50-year lease with the Union Pacific Railroad. And I think it may not be instinctive to think about it, but there is platted right-of-way for 4th Street, but there's also a strip of ground that is leased by the city from the Union Pacific Railroad. And so these shaded areas there represent a lease area, and basically the city is leasing ground from the railroad that allows us to have a street there, and those the lease area can be used for the usual ordinary purposes of a street or highway. Union Pacific has interpreted this rather strictly, and they don't think things like fences or parked vehicles are part of the ordinary purposes of a street or highway. Although I think we all agree that on-street parking on 4th Street has occurred for years, apparently unbeknownst to the railroad. So on the west side of 4th Street, the street pavement is about 36 feet wide, and it's partially located in the railroad right-of-way, and it's partially located in platted public right-of-way. On the east side, the paving is 32 feet wide, and the roadway is located entirely in the railroad right-of-way. So what you have is you have a strip of rail right-of-way with a paved street in it, and then next to that you have a strip of platted street right-of-way or road right-of-way, which does not have any part of the street in it. And so in 1925, there was a vacation of the east and west 10 feet of Osborne Street right-of-way that reduced the width of that right-of-way from 80 feet to 60 feet. And then in 1930, Russell Avenue and the two east-west alleys were vacated, so they were wiped out. And then in 1940, Kansas Wesleyan began construction of Glenn Martin Stadium along the east side of 4th Street. So these improvements that are there today, the Glenn Martin Stadium grandstand, the field, those things, the initial construction on that began in 1940. So the purpose of the application that we have today is that the proposal is to replat this block that you see pictured on the screen, and the goal is to create an slightly expanded campus for Kansas Wesleyan University Sports Complex addition. And that would be to accommodate football, soccer, softball, and track facilities with a practice field located in the southeast corner. And what we want to emphasize today, and you see at the end of your report, one of the things that was decided on in our multiple meetings with Kansas Wesleyan and Wilson and Company is that they're going to pursue approval of the actual improvements inside this campus through a PDD or Plan Development District process. But the thing that the replat does is it establishes just how big that campus is. So their goal through this replat is to widen the east-west dimension of the sports complex by 42 feet by adding vacated right-of-way from Osborne here and vacated right-of-way from 4th Street here, and also adding 10 feet of vacated right-of-way from Claflin there to also deepen that lot. So their original plan was that they were going to close the northbound leg of South 4th and vacate the right-of-way there, and that the west side would remain unchanged but as a one-way south street. And then Claflin, they were going to request vacation of the south 10 feet of Claflin Avenue right-of-way, and they weren't changing the roadway at all, but we're proposing to add additional recessed parking all along here. There are some there today, but they were basically looking to go from Fourth all the way to Osborne with recessed on-street parking. On Osborne, the plan was to vacate the west 18 feet of the right-of-way, which would reduce its width to 42 feet and to reduce the paving width from 37 feet to 21 feet and make it a one-way street northbound, and Cloud Street was essentially untouched. Their original plan was based on transferring the lease rights that the city had with the railroad to Kansas Wesleyan, closing that leg of 4th Street to motor vehicle traffic and converting that area to a pedestrian plaza and essentially putting up a fence right along the west boundary of northbound 4th Street. Wilson & Company and Kansas Wesleyan, to our knowledge, have not been able to obtain the Union Pacific Railroad's approval of that plan, and they've now submitted a revised plan. And the revised plan is what you see on the screen. And under this revised plan, northbound 4th Street would remain as an open public street. There is some chance that the pavement width may be narrowed to create a buffer between the curb line and a proposed fence, but there'll be further discussion about that. But under this plan, the city of Salina would maintain its lease. It would still be a public street, and instead of the fence being over here on the west side of northbound 4th Street, it would be on the east side of northbound 4th Street, about 15 feet away from the edge of the grandstand. So the replat that we're talking about would merge those 30 individual lots that I showed you into one platted lot. The proposed lot would measure 590 feet north-south and 552 feet east-west and would contain 7.47 acres. So the site today has 6.79 acres. Under this proposal, it would grow to 7.47 acres, and the primary purpose of that is to fit a eight-lane competition track around the football field and what would also serve as a soccer field. So we've summarized for you on page 3 and 4 what the status is of the existing streets. So on 4th Street, we have 160 feet of total right-of-way. 100 of that belongs to the railroad, and it is a local residential street. On Claflin, there's 100 feet of right-of-way. The street is 41 feet wide. It's a minor arterial going from Santa Fe over to 9th Street, but going east, it is a local residential street. Osborne has 60 feet of right-of-way. In 2007, partially in anticipation of changes that might be made to 4th Street, Osborne Street was reconstructed, and it was widened from 33 feet to 37 feet, which is our Collector Street standard. The applicant is now proposing to reduce the right-of-way width to 42 feet and the paving width to 20 or 21 feet. And again, there would be no change to Cloud Street. So with the revision to this plan, the only changes to the existing street and traffic circulation pattern being proposed is the narrowing of Osborne Street and conversion to a one-way street and a one-way street with no on-street parking. So the plan would be that instead of 60 feet of right-of-way with 37 feet of paving and a two-way street that allows for on-street parking, it would be narrowed to 42 feet of right-of-way, 20 or 21 feet of paving, which would not allow for on-street parking. And we do have, as you can see from the aerial photo, there's a number of duplexes and rental houses on the east side of Osborne. Some of those currently have no on-street parking or off-street parking, and they utilize on-street parking for their tenants. They are required by code to have off-street parking, but historically They were allowed to be built without a requirement for having driveways or off-street parking. So it's a grandfathered or non-conforming situation. And then the recess parking that is proposed up along this area, as you are aware, is not permitted anywhere within the city except in the Santa Fe Central Business District. And so that would require special approval by the city commission to use the right-of-way for recessed parking. We have not identified any public or franchise utility lines that would be installed or extended as part of this project or would need to be, or easements would need to be vacated. We did want to make clear, and this is a matter of some discussion, is right where this fence line is, right here. In 1998, the city put in a project to help drain the Claflin 9th Street intersection, which was not draining well, and we put in a large 42-inch storm pipeline to drain that intersection back to the east and into the 2nd Street slough. And this fence line, as proposed, sits almost over the top of that sewer line, or storm sewer pipeline. And so there are two aspects to the drainage here. Is one, are any of the physical changes here going to create a need for any storm water detention? And is that pipe adequate to handle all this runoff that will be directed to it? And then the second aspect of that deals with the city's ability to access and maintain that pipe. And so we have Mr. Nelson here representing the engineering department, but they are rightfully concerned that the proposed fence line and support posts right here are stationed or would be stationed almost over the top of that pipeline, which would make accessing that for maintenance purposes difficult in the future. And so in our discussions with Kansas Westland Wilson Company, they are proposing that instead of relocating the fence line, that some sort of agreement be entered into between Kansas Westland and the city of Salina, whereby Kansas Westland would agree to remove fence panels as needed to allow city crews to obtain access to the storm pipeline. The good news is it's a storm pipeline, which means there's less likelihood of a need for immediate emergency repairs like you would have with a ruptured water line or ruptured sewer line. But nonetheless, it's a 42-inch major pipeline, and getting access to that is important. So to summarize, over here they're talking about vacating 24 feet of 4th Street right-of-way, 10 feet of Claflin right-of-way, and 18 feet of Osborne right-of-way. And these vacations are needed to allow them to expand the width and depth of this block to accommodate the football field, the 8-lane track configuration, and fit a soccer field within the boundaries of the track area. I think we pointed out that the comprehensive plan shows this as a public, quasi-public land use area, and this would certainly fit within that classification. So the hat that you're wearing today is that you are looking at this replat application, but you're also conducting a hearing to receive comments from the public and input from them about proposed changes to the traffic flow and the traffic circulation pattern. And some of the things that you are to take into account would be emergency vehicle access, traffic flow and public safety, and future land use and development patterns, which is probably the least important factor here because we have a pretty established area. But just a couple things to think about. There is a fire station on South Santa Fe, and they use 4th Street frequently as their means to get south down to Cloud Street. And so they have reviewed this, and they are comfortable with The west leg remaining is one way south and basically remaining unchanged. The other thing to think about is the schools that are in the vicinity. If you, we have St. Mary's Elementary, we have Sacred Heart High School and Middle School. We also have South Middle School, which is south of Cloud Street on 4th Street. All of those patterns would be potentially affected here. So some things to think about would be, should Osborne be one way north or one way south? Or a third option is there a way to reduce the right-of-way but somehow keep a sufficient pavement width within the 42-foot right-of-way to still allow for either two-way traffic or one-way traffic with parking? So again, we're starting with a pavement width of 37 feet on Osborne. So as we pointed out in the report, there will be a plan development district application that will be coming forward on this. That will be scheduled for a public hearing on October 15th. But we think today's meeting is important so that representatives of Kansas Wesleyan and Wilson & Company can both respond to questions but also take notes, and staff can take notes to have homework items to address in anticipation of that future October hearing. And so it would be important for staff and representatives of Kansas Wesleyan and Wilson & Company to respond to any questions the Planning Commission has, and then it's very important that we hear input from members of the public. We have two items that we would refer you to. In your packet is an email from Melissa Maddox, and she resides at 229 East Claflin, and she states she's lived there for 27 years and she is supportive of this project, but she thinks it's very important that adequate off-street parking be provided, and that is her primary concern. And then you also have a letter at your places from Doug Hill, and Mr. Hill owns these apartment units right here that face Cloud Street but are accessed off of Osborne right here. And he has provided some written comments and concerns that he has about the proposal. So before I accept any questions, Mr. Nelson, do you want to amplify anything about either the drainage analysis or the storm pipeline? And then we can open it up to questions.
Well, Mr. Andrew, I would just reiterate what you had said earlier about the location of that 42-inch line and the proposed location of the fence along Claflin Avenue. It is a concern, certainly, for maintenance or future work that we would, if we should have to get in and do that. Certainly, as Mr. Andrew had noted, being a storm collection system, the likelihood of it being a crisis situation like such as a water line break or a storm or a sanitary sewer where we would have to get in immediately, I think we would be able to work with Kansas Wesleyan to get the fence taken down and give us the room that we might need then to perform any maintenance. I would next direct my comments to the drainage report that Wilson & Company provided. They have essentially the same amount of area that's being drained, just a little bit more, but the plan would redirect a considerable amount more of the runoff to the Claflin Street storm collection, an increase of a little more than 36%. Certainly the collection system that Wilson Company is proposing is a below-ground collection system, gravel and collection pipes that would provide storage as a detention basin, and then that would be able to be metered out at a pre-existing or less than the pre-existing amounts being discharged into the Claflin Avenue system. So the plan for that has not been submitted or developed at this time. However, it is a very viable option, and at this point, we believe that would be a suitable solution to the situation that we have here today.
Thank you.
I guess we would see if you have any questions about any of the information that we provided in the staff report, either in terms of the status of 4th Street or the other thing that we pointed out and want to point out is that we have a pedestrian crossing signal at the corner of Osborne and Cloud, and that pedestrian signal is set up also is a traffic control signal, and it controls the outflow of Osborne onto Cloud Street. So if you changed Osborne from two-way to one-way north only, then it would no longer need to serve that function, and there would probably need to be a redesign of that signal there. If you make Osborne one-way southbound, then the signal would pretty well function as it does today. And so I think we will try to address any questions we can about 4th Street, but it seems like with the modified plan, the biggest impact would be to converting Osborne to a narrower one-way street with no on-street parking would be the biggest change proposed as part of this. So I'll open it up to any questions you have of staff, and if not, then we should hear from the applicant.
Questions of staff?
I have one, if I may.
Sure.
Just because I can't recall, what pedestrian traffic from the crossing there for basically the Sacred Heart Elementary Children going up Osborne, is there a sidewalk on either side of that street right now?
I might defer to Mr. Berger. He might be more familiar with the area. Are you aware of a sidewalk on Osborne, John?
Not on the south.
I believe there is a narrow sidewalk on the west side of Osborne.
On the west side, near the football practice field?
No.
Okay. There's no sidewalk now. I just looking at it, if you put the fence will obviously go very close along the west side of the proposed area, or the east side proposed area, so there won't be room for children to walk on that side. They'll have to walk on the east side of Osborne when they go to and from school, Sacred Heart primary. I don't think it'll affect South Middle likely because they won't come up that way, but mostly the Sacred Heart kids. Just thought I'd mention that.
Doesn't appear to be a sidewalk on either side. I don't know where they walk now.
So the pattern's now circular as proposed. Do we have any information about how much traffic there is in the opposite directions that are proposed to be closed?
There was a traffic study that was done previously by Wilson and Company, but part of that, as part of what drove that, was the initial proposal or request was to close Claflin Street to traffic and Santa Fe at Kerwin instead of Claflin. So it was addressing a lot of that. But that is, we think it's very important to get some clarity as to whether we're talking about Osborne being one way north or one way south, because that will impact patterns. And another thing to think about is that there's quite a few parents that come and parishioners that come out of this parking lot for Sacred Heart and St. Mary's, and it's quite a bit easier to make a right-hand turn to get over to Osborne to go northbound, and if you take that option away, you're forcing everybody to make a left-hand turn on the cloud to get over to 4th Street to go north, because they wouldn't be able to use Osborne anymore. So that is something to think about. But the three things that are really in play there is it one way only northbound? Is it one way only southbound? Or is there a way, even reducing the right-of-way to 42 feet, to maintain a two-way flow in there?
What are the current traffic counts north and south on Osborne? Does anybody know?
When the 2000 paving was done, it was about 300 vehicles a day.
And about equal north and south?
It's equal based on time of day. It's more northbound in the morning and more southbound in the afternoon. But the purpose of those signals there is not because there's a warrant because of the traffic on the street. It's there because to provide a place for St. Mary's students to cross Cloud Street.
Basically, it's not very high. How high is the traffic count on 4th Street, north and south?
I'm not sure I have that number in front of me, but we can certainly do that.
Other questions of staff? If there are no more questions of staff, may we hear from the applicant? And if you would, please, your name and address for the secretary. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Matt Thompson. I'm the president of Kansas Wesleyan University at 100 East Claflin Avenue. And it's my pleasure to speak to you today. I appreciate the time and your interest in reviewing this matter for us. We believe the new plan that we propose, while it's different than the one that was originally proposed about 5 years ago, is a much better fit both for the campus as well as for the community to serve both needs. The main difference you'll see, as Mr. Andrew has already recognized, is the track that's been added. One of the things that we have been requesting that we look at throughout this last 5 years is why is there not a track as a part of this? And the simple answer was there was not enough room. And so in conversation with the city and looking at if there was ways to spread out the land just a little bit, we could make that fit. And that's why the request came. Initially, we had requested closing of 4th Street to allow there to be even more buffers traveling around throughout the site itself. Union Pacific was not amenable to those conversations, and so we have squeezed back in to fit within this pattern the space that we are proposing today. And doing so would allow us to have safe movement around there. We are concerned that if we went any tighter, so to speak, to give up the extra request that we have on Osborne Street, would not allow for enough safe runoff space for football and soccer players, for track people to use. It's important that this facility is designed this way, not only to serve our needs, but also to serve the community, Sacred Heart being a primary user, but we also hope to be a site for future regional high school competitions to come to the city. It would draw people into the community throughout the year. And so I'd be happy to answer any questions. I'll defer all the really hard questions to the engineers in terms of very deep specifics, but I'd be happy to answer general questions about the overview of the plan.
Well, it's a great plan. I've always viewed Wesleyan as, when I was a younger person, as a hub of the older part of the city, and it's a hub of the southern part of the city now. So to me, planning-wise, it makes good sense for you to better define all of your borders or your layout of your campus. So that said, what about some of the parking issues? And your people proposed the plan for the engineering department about moving the fences around a little bit to have access to the sewers in there. You think you can handle some of the parking issues?
We can. Based on our long-term parking plan, we actually have more than enough parking with our long-term relationship with Sacred Heart. And so even the parking along Claflin is not required to meet the needs for this. We're putting them in as an extra asset and benefit to the community to have that parking there. And so that's part of the reason we want to leave the fence where it is so we can have an appropriate border for protection and safety. But we technically aren't required to put that parking there. Putting it there, again, for the better use of everybody, allowing then for some handicap parking as well to make it easier and more accessible to the property.
Well, I'm going to guess when we hear from the public, they'll have some concerns about where parking does occur, and I'm sure if most folks are like me, they like to park at the most convenient place they can put their car when they're coming to activities, and sometimes that's not always what the plan has thought through. So I know there's lots of parking over there at Sacred Heart, but I'm sure the neighbors are concerned about where people will put their cars.
Sure. There are scheduled main entrance areas both at the north and south, north of the stadium off of Claflin, as well as off the south area off of Cloud. So that would give an entry, major entry point from right across from Sacred Heart where all that parking would be located, and we drive people to that parking lot as being the kind of the main entrance to the site would be from the south. So we'd encourage people to park there, as well as encouraging people to park on campus using our facilities that are on campus and walking over to the facility. We believe people will tailgate and do activities on campus and then move en masse as it's time for the games over to that facility as well. We also have been working with some of our neighbors to make sure all of their parking, there is adequate off-street parking for them. And my understanding now is all of those homes that front Osborne now have parking either off-street or around on Russell as well. So all those homes have been addressed.
I would agree with that. I mean, I took a drive through and everybody's got a place to park, it looks like. Not a lot, but there's access and parking there.
You also own land where the Hodges medical thing is. Is that right?
That's correct. Between the Hodges building and the University of United Methodist
right.
Church, we own that parking lot there. That is actually
right.
part of our parking as well.
So that would be converted into parking also?
Oh, it already is parking, yes,
oh,
sir.
Okay.
All the portions that we own have already been converted into paved parking.
Do you use that Hodges parking when you have an agreement with them to use their parking when they're not open?
We have an agreement with Hodges. We don't.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. We'd be happy to talk with them, but do not currently have something in place.
Any other questions?
Dean left. If I heard Dean correct on there, does that the parking along 4th Street heading south along the railroad, is that going to bring light to it? Or is that not supposed to be parking now? Is that posted no parking? I mean, obviously everybody parks along through there, but I believe Dean said that the railroad either didn't know what was going on. It seems like most of the parking happens going south, and then on football games, I guess they park on the,
right.
which would be headed north on there. I just wonder if that brings new light to it. I mean, I would imagine 40 cars park along there, college kids during the daytime.
On the west side going south, it is striped for parking.
It is striped for
yes.
parking. Okay.
It is. It's the northbound that is not striped for parking, and we'd work in compliance to make sure there was a perfect signage postage not to park along.
Yeah, and I don't see that. That's why I misunderstood Dean then. So the south side is signed for parking.
Yes.
The railroad's okay with that.
Can't speak to that, but
yeah.
it is striped. I can tell you that.
Yep.
Other questions for the applicant? We may have you or your engineers back after
right.
the public wants to give their comments. May bring up some points that we haven't been contemplated. This is a public session, so we'd like to hear from the public. It's our major purpose today. So if there's anybody that'd like to come up and address the commission about this replat, we'd like to hear it today. And I guess somebody's got to be first. And if you wouldn't mind, for the record, we'd like your name and address for the secretary.
Okay, we'll start. My name's John, or Jack Morris. This is my wife, Lori Brax, and we own a property at 1609 Osborne. It's a little white cottage that faces the tennis courts. And we also live south and east of there. And so we travel this area a lot as well, too. We live on Edwards Street. But the house on 1609 is a rental property of ours. And our concern mostly is the increase in traffic. First of all, we're very happy that KWU is planning to build a new stadium, and it will be a great addition to the town. There's no doubt about that. And it's long overdue. But the property is along Osborne. We're really concerned about ours and the neighbors, because what I got in the mail said basically that Osborne would be reduced to one way and no parking, and right now it's two-way and parking on both sides of the street. So that's a pretty drastic change. A lot of people in this town rely on off-street or on-street parking because they just have one-car garages and one-car driveways. Even on Edward, we park one of our cars on the street a lot of times. Our rental at 1609 has a one-car driveway, so the renters are either going to have to decide who's leaving first in the morning or, well, I guess that's what they'll have to do if there's no on-street parking at the moment. The house next to us did not have a driveway at all until about 2 weeks ago, and that's been taken care of, I understand. The St. Mary and Sacred Heart properties create a lot of traffic also. And so you might be well aware of the traffic on Cloud, but as I said, the people down where we live often want to get downtown, and so they come up Quincy Street, and they often they jog over to Osborne, and then go up to Claflin and over to Santa Fe. It's a very common route. But they can also take 4th Street, which is going to be closed also under the current plan. So it would take away, and boy, if you made that southbound, that'd really be a problem. If you made Osborne southbound only, they wouldn't be able to go on Osborne or 4th Street to get to Santa Fe. So there's quite a bit of traffic in that area. The drainage is a problem as well. I know I actually rented one of those units when I first came to town about 8 years ago in the 1700 block, and it flooded both in the fall and spring that first year I got here, and the city is taking care of that drainage really well, and the road's really wide and nice now. So we're also concerned about the drainage, and well, of course, the value to the homes all along there. But I don't know how many homes are in those two blocks. I'd say eight or about eight, maybe 10. And if you go from, you know, two-way traffic, parking on both sides to just one with no parking on the street, it's certainly going to affect the value of those properties. Did you want to add anything?
I did have a question about the traffic study. Was that in the year 2000? Is that when that was? Because that was 13 years ago, and a lot of development has been on the south side, and I would wonder if that has changed since the year 2000. So I would like to have that, you know, monitored again. So, and then, yeah, just about the renters, we have had some comments that it would be, you know, a hardship for them to not be able to park on the street, and also that it was questionable as to where their company, like if they had any company, where their company would park when they had visitors. So anyway, we do appreciate Kansas Wesleyan and the, you know, what they're doing. You know, it's great, and it is long overdue. But we'd hate to see our properties go down and not be able to park on that street. So anyway,
thank you.
Question for you, real quick, just to make clarification: with the new plan, they have no. Is that correct? You're not closing 4th Street either which way. Okay, so okay. So the new plan, I just want to make clarification on that okay. 4th Street now, with the talking to the railroad, they're not thinking of closing that either which way. That will remain exactly the same, okay. Correct? Just want to make clarification there.
I just request that we be allowed to have the off-street parking.
Sure.
That would really
second,
be great.
Just a second question for you, yes. Real quick. Given your home that's there, is there any way, is there enough footage to pour a second pad?
Well, I suppose we could if we used up the front yard, you know.
Okay, but yeah, I'm trying to come up with a, just thinking outside the box.
The drive goes right next to the house,
okay.
One lane, you could put a second, you know, the concrete next to the current one-car garage, I suppose.
Yeah. I'm just thinking of a magic cement truck pulled up with a coyote on the side of it and pulled your porta pad.
Yeah.
You know, whether that...
A two-car garage would be good.
Again, that's why we're here. We're taking
notes.
We'd
probably go for that.
I'm sorry, we don't have the traffic counts for you, but we may get further information on that before that October 15th meeting.
Thank you.
Mr. Anybody Ryan, else like to address the commission?
Mr. Ryan, I would just note that the last traffic study was in 2006.
2006, okay.
My name's Brian Cox. I live at 1717 Osborne. I live on the corner of Osborne and Cloud. I just want to say I'm for the stadium, too. I think it would be a great deal. But I don't like the one-way traffic idea and no on-street parking. Well, I have a driveway right now that is on Cloud Street, but it's a one car. And we have two vehicles. And besides the fact, if somebody comes to visit or anything like that, there's no parking whatsoever. So... I mean, that's my main concern. You know, the rest of it is fine, but that's all I have.
Do you have concerns about it affecting the value of your
property?
Well,
I do. Well, I think it's going
to
do I think it's going to do that too.
Maybe on the other side of that, it's going to improve the value of your property once they do all the improvements
in
the neighborhood.
Maybe. The other thing is, you know, went in there in 2007 and widened the road. Because Kansas Wesleyan was saying for the extra traffic and everything. And now they're coming back and needing that to expand the stadium. Well, we're talking about 18 feet. So, I mean, I don't know. It just seems like a lot for 18 feet. But, all right.
Any questions for Mr. Cox? Thank you, sir. Are there others that would like to address the commission?
Hi, my name is Marcia Carpenter. My address is actually 237 East Kerwin, but my house and my garage face Osborne. And my biggest concern is I leave early in the morning and I go south. And if you hit traffic at Cloud Street and you make it a one-way north, and I go to Quincy and then go south there. And what I figured out with this Magnolia thing is to have to turn around and go Cloud to 9th Street and south. It kind of makes it another 5-10 minute drive sometimes if you hit all those lights red. So my main worry is that I won't be able to get back and forth from my house. With 4th Street being open now, at least it gives me a little bit of an option. But it's still going to cause a lot of traffic with the school and the parking. And I don't know if you guys have ever been out there at 8 o'clock in the morning or 3:30 in the afternoon. If I'm running home, that traffic coming out of Sacred Heart, they're trying to turn into Sacred Heart, they're trying to turn out of Sacred Heart. And I know he was talking about taking that light out at Cloud Street. I think that light is very good to have there because then it at least gives the people coming out of Sacred Heart or going in Sacred Heart a little bit of a chance to be able to get in with the rest of the traffic flow. So. Any questions for me?
What's the next street to the east from Osborne?
It is Quincy, or Quincy going south, but it offsets Quincy.
Well, not off of Cloud, but off of Claflin.
Off of Claflin.
And you're going east towards
Quincy.
Ohio. Is Quincy.
Quincy.
But it jogs.
But it jogs, so then you've still got to turn against traffic to go south on Quincy. It jogs, it is to the
Well, you have to turn
east.
Against it on Cloud,
yes.
Or you have to turn
against
it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
One place or the
So
other.
At least I have a light so I can turn.
Mm-hmm.
If it's north, going north, then I'm going to have to turn up either on 4th Street or on Quincy against traffic to get south to Quincy. Because it just makes it easier for me not to have to hit all those red lights
right.
on 9th Street. And I work out south of Magnolia. So.
Any other questions?
Okay. Thank you guys so much for at least listening to our concerns.
Are there others that would like to address the commission from the public? If there are not, would the Wilson engineers have anything further to comment to us? If we've heard something that you think they're, and there will be future times to comment on these matters. If there's no more public comment, I'll bring it back to the commissioners. Is there more discussion?
Staff would have a couple items that we would want to mention as possible homework items and get response from Wilson and Company and Kansas Wesleyan University and get some input from you whether you think that would be helpful. When I went back to the 2006 traffic study, it had lots of flow arrows and things and recommendations about changing directions, but it was rather lacking in traffic counts. So I'm hearing getting some up-to-date traffic counts would be important. An item that we think would be beneficial, again, we're looking forward to the hearing on the 15th of October, would be a cross-section of the east leg of 4th Street looking from Cloud North, just to get a kind of a view of what that would look like in the cross-section if you're sitting at Cloud and you're looking north in terms of where fences would be, where the grandstand would be, what kind of width that we're talking about. I think getting a cross-section of Osborne in terms of where, if the right-of-way is reduced to 42 feet, where the pavement would sit within that right-of-way and what room is left in the right-of-way for things such as sidewalks that might improve pedestrian accessibility. And then also we think it would be important to get a cross-section of the Claflin Avenue property line just to get a picture of where the fence is in relation to the storm pipeline. And then there were some discussion. The fencing that we're discussing is wrought iron with 2-foot by 2-foot masonry piers. And there was some discussion about not having the masonry piers up here or not having them as frequently because it's a lot harder to move a masonry pier out from over a pipeline than it is a section of wrought iron fence. So we had some discussions. The other item we think is important is that we're getting some rough projections on the number of seats in the new grandstand, but we would need some analysis from Wilson and Company as to how many seats Glenn Martin Stadium has today, how many it would have under the new plan. And it is the, if there's any increase in seating, then that's what we need to address from a parking standpoint. So those were some items that staff had identified. We wanted to at least get those out there and see if there were others that in any motion to continue the hearing on this item to the 15th that you would like to see addressed between now and the 15th. I think that would be helpful to include in the motion, and so those were some items that we identified.
Any other items, gentlemen, you'd like to just add to the consideration?
Maybe a question, maybe just a comment. I'm not sure which this will be when I'm finished with it, but I don't suppose it's possible. Is there ever such a thing as a one-way street, one lane? Then if you made Osborne one way north, which I know some of you didn't like, but I mean, I understand that, but at least you could have one lane north and leave on-street parking on the left-hand side if you're headed north or on the west side of Osborne. So you'd have on-street parking and traffic one way going north.
What we need to take into account from our number standpoint, and I'll just give you the example because it's one I'm most familiar with, the west leg of Huntington Road.
Okay.
Huntington Road is one way south, and it's one way north on the east leg. And on the west leg, it's specifically, I know that the width of that is 21 feet. And there's no on-street parking allowed on Huntington's west leg because you have to figure about 8 feet of width for an on-street parking space. So if you take 21 feet and you take 8 feet of that for a parked car, a fire emergency access lane has to have at least 20 feet of clear width. So if you have a 21-foot wide street and you take up 18 feet of that with a parked car, then you only have 13 feet left, which does not give you a fire access lane. So the primary purpose of not allowing the on-street parking on Osborne is to preserve a 20-foot clear aisle for emergency access vehicles, and the prescribed width for that is 20 clear feet. So in order to get there, we would need to look at, say, widening that to something on the order of, not widening because it's already 37 feet, but trying to preserve 28 or 29 feet right. of paving, and then you could conceivably have a one-way street, but preserve the option of having on-street parking.
And because if it's going north, the on-street parking would logically be on the off-side because then your traffic would line right. up when it
you'd
goes to two lanes.
You'd probably use the left side for through traffic.
I mean, it kind of would accomplish both, but you'd have to have 30 foot of road.
And so that is one of the things I think should be a homework item for Wilson & Company is to develop a couple different cross-sections for Osborne Street. So you could say if you've got 42 feet of right-of-way, this is what we can fit in there, because the other thing you have to look at is that it's one thing when you narrow the right-of-way of a street, but in this case they're taking all the 18 feet out of one side of it, so we've already got a fixed width of right-of-way between the curb and the east right-of-way line. We can't do much with that, but it would seem to be helpful to get a cross-section of Osborne and to see if there's any possibility for somehow maintaining a one-way street but being able to preserve on-street parking. That would require, in our estimation, about 28-29 feet of paving.
That's just my thought.
I'm used to living on a substandard street, I guess, because I think my street's only about 22 feet wide and it's two-way traffic and it's parking legal on both sides. And so this weekend when people had guests, you have basically one lane that you can drive through, and you just have to take turns and hope it works out. I would think, in this case, that Osborne going south with the parking on the east side and being would only have to be 20, well, it'd have to be like Huntington. You already said the 21 feet wide isn't wide enough by today's standards, but the reality is there are lots of worse streets already out there that are only in that width. So again, we need the details, but I still like the idea if 4th Street's still going to be there northbound, then go ahead and reduce the size of Osborne some, keep parking on at least one side of it, and make it southbound so that the traffic signal still works the way it does today for
and
a lot of
work.
Trips, and it
worked
too.
That puts parking in front
and
of
it puts the parking right in front of the dwelling units.
4th Street's going to be southbound, right?
Well, the west side of 4th Street.
4th Street will basically be unchanged from what it is today. The west leg will be southbound, and the east leg will be northbound.
Where we need traffic counts. I mean, when I went through 4th Street today about 9 o'clock in the morning, southbound, it's just like driving through a parking lot. There's cars on both sides of the southbound lane. There were a lot of cars parked in the northbound lane. I didn't try to drive up it, but there were a lot of vehicles in the northbound lane also at 9 o'clock in the morning with school in session and maintenance going on and whatever else is happening on 4th Street through the campus. But treating both streets basically as parking lots is probably okay, keeping the speed down to 15 miles an hour or so. And especially when there's a big event going on there, that's going to happen no matter what. You're going to have to just be creeping through there because there are going to be so many people in the vicinity. But then that's only a few days a year where there's a big event at that sports complex. At any rate, we do need some...
On 4th Street, the width on the west leg is 36 feet, so you've got 8-foot car, 8-foot car, and a 20-foot middle is essentially what you have.
Right. But you have pedestrians and, oh, today we had a little quad utility vehicle guy with a trailer and lawn equipment trying to get through there, too, at 9 o'clock in the morning, and he was kind of scratching his head and wondering if he was ever going to get a turn, it looked like. But at any rate, that's the sort of thing that will happen, and we do need more alternatives on Osborne. I still think that's the most critical street.
Are there any more comments for the record? Could we have a motion then to postpone consideration?
One last one real quick. Mr. Boxer brought it up too, and I wanted to answer that on there. With that being a practice field, does that definitely have to be that particular width? With that being the practice field over the side, that's not the legal soccer field as well, is it? You're going to play soccer on the actual football field? And would be reducing 10 feet or 5 feet or something like that from the practice facility. Sure. Would that hamper that?
This is a practice field for football. That's the width of it. That's the way it's currently scheduled. And within the track would be a performance field for soccer and for football. The idea is that soccer doesn't typically practice on a full width field, and so they're fine on a football field width. And that's the reason we've gone with the reduced size there. To reduce it more would be a limitation for us.
So the soccer field is wider, the regulation?
That's right. Okay. That's the outer band you see, because it's like stripes down the side of the football field within the track. That's the actual soccer lines that continue that far out. Again, soccer doesn't typically practice on a full width field for various reasons.
Okay, thank you.
May I just make one other comment?
Sure.
We're going to have an open house on campus on September 10th for all of our neighbors. They've all received invitations, but just wanted on the record that others are invited to come and for us to discuss this all further and other items and more detail what the actual plan will look like beyond just kind of the overview. So,
at what time?
6:30 in the Hopley Student Center on the 10th.
We have a letter at our stations here from a Mr. Douglas Hill, I believe it is. And have you received a copy of that? Are there other comments for the record? And I think our next step is to move to postpone this to the October 15th meeting with the staff's recommendations for further study items. Is there a motion?
I'd make a motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further comments? All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? We'll see you all on the 15th of October, and thank you very much for being here.
And most of you got a letter. We'll be getting another letter inviting you to come on the 15th.
Other matters?
We have no other matters for you other than we have scheduled the 17th. Your next meeting would be your annual business meeting. We hope to have city commission appointments by then to the various boards, and then we would be electing officers as well as looking at volunteers or non-volunteers to serve on the BZA Heritage Commission and as various liaisons. So,
well, Chairman, you mean I can appoint him?
Chairman could appoint somebody.
You better all be nice to him.
So that is all the business we have for you this evening.
And will we have two or three new members?
Mr. Mike Sell is the only one going off. Mr. Story and Mr. Kennedy are eligible for reappointment.
Okay.
So the only one that's actually going off is Mr. Mike Sell.
I got my letter. I think I've been reappointed, haven't I?
Okay. The City Commission is meeting on Monday for the mayor to make appointments. So the clerk's office knows more than we do. So.
Okay.
We usually don't find out till the agenda goes out.
Have we had any interest of junior members at all?
I've not heard anything from Gina, but we'll touch base with her to see if we've got any high school or middle school students who have signed up. They didn't have any appear on my list, but there's a separate expression of interest for that, so we can follow up on that.
Okay. Thank you very much. We're adjourned.
We're actually done.
Berg in 2009 has 20%.